The objective of the ULS-A JCTD is to provide a logistics capability to the forward edge of the battle area, basically the last tactical mile. What we've found in past conflicts, and actually current conflicts, is that we have struggled somewhat with providing logistics to the forward areas, and we've gotten a lot of people hurt or killed because of the way we've done this with convoys or with rotary wing lift.
The warfighter is our number one focus. It's why we're doing what we're doing. The JCTD as a whole is meant to lower the activation energy that's required to actually get a capability into the hands of a warfighter. So because of that, it's entirely important for us to have them involved as much as possible so that we can solicit their feedback and appropriately inform follow-on programs with a capstone military utility assessment that comes from our independent assessors and the feedback from the warfighters.
Technology has reached the point where we can build systems that can do many of the jobs that soldiers or Marines could do without risking a human and without further loading down the individual soldier or the individual Marine.
So the ULS-A program is really a game changer for the military in terms of logistics.
The threat always dictates the tactic. And right now, given the threat that we have with current conflicts and potentially future conflicts, an unmanned capability is desirable because it continues to provide a capability that doesn't put people in harm's way. The unmanned logistics system, AIR, has demonstrated the ability to move logistics to points of need and provide a critical capability that currently doesn't exist at the level we've been doing it.
What Near Earth is doing in a program like this is providing a system that makes the aircraft aware of its surroundings so that basically can operate safely even when there's not an aviator or an operator present. If somebody had made a mistake in sending it somewhere, even if there's, say, a tree in the landing area, it can understand that and respond to it appropriately so that the supplies can get where they need to go, even in a very dynamic situation where the aircraft is not the center of attention. It's one of the things you're using to get the job done.
So my experiences flying drones are very minimal. Other than the training out here, this is actually the first time I've been responsible for the flight of a drone in general. So the training they provided us, and especially the in the classroom and then out in the field breakup, was extremely easy to pick up. They told us, you know, here's how we input GPS coordinates, the TRV settings that you needed to use, and then from that PowerPoint presentation in class, we were able to immediately go out in the field and do a couple hours of hands-on using that system.
I hadn't had too much previous experience with ATAC or obviously a GCS at all, but the way that their plugin works with CCM hooks, it makes it pretty user-friendly.
In a deployed setting, the TRV, I think, would bridge the gap between, you know, large-scale movements, you know, where it's mostly troops and supplies. You're moving in a Chinook, say, 40 personnel at a time, and smaller movements where all they need is a resupply of ammo. It doesn't really require a full helicopter load. So I think it really is going to fill a capabilities gap of what level of resources you're dedicating to a mission and what's actually required for the mission to be completed.
The fact that we can deliver equipment and water and food, ammo, all of that without having to put a soldier on the ground, either in a vehicle, on the road, risking IED strike, risking enemy contact. We can straight shot it out if we need to. We can make it take, you know, a grid point, waypoint system to get it out of hazard areas that we know of. But yeah, we get to keep those guys that don't need to be out on the ground off the ground.